Hey everybody. So to me, basically since the inception of the ChatGPT era, the inception of the ChatGPT era has been premised off of a particular conclusion, which is that scaling laws hold for AI and that scaling laws matter for AI and hold the same for AI as they do for compute scaling. And then within this paper that we're looking at here, I think that they sum it up well in the abstract of this paper or in the introduction, where they say that the scaling laws of deep learning dictate that larger models with higher dimensional widths generally yield better performance. And then so this is scaling laws, right? And this is true. And then but within that, there's been roadblocks that and like unexpected roadblocks that have been hit within this, right? Like this is a true statement on its own, but this being a true statement doesn't have the same impact for AI as it does for compute overall, in general, right? And then just pointing that out, and then so and pointing it out. This paper is called "Directly Constructing Low-Dimensional Solution Subspaces in Deep Neural Networks," and it's put out on December 29th, 2025. They make a very specific break, like a formalization within this research paper, and their formalization is that there is a difference between the search space and the solution space within a model, and that when your scaling laws very specifically apply to the search space and not the solution space. And then so why do they not apply to the solution space? Because as they point out within this research paper, the solution space within the model is a very low dimensional space, right? And then so I can intrinsically show you and prove to you through the experiments that I do based off of this paper that the solution space is 20 dimensions or less. And then very specifically, like you can get a majority of the solution space in 8 dimensions or less. And then so this paper is very, they do a lot of formalizations of like manifold collapse and then a geometric construction around the manifold and then low dimensional manifold theory, etc. So great job overall with this research paper, with regards towards a lot of that formalization. It's cool to have it formalized, but to me, let's talk about the practicality of this, right? And then to me, the practicality of this overall is that the bet on scaling laws was wrong, flat out. And then so, why intelligence lives in a small solution space. And so for years, modern AI has been guided by a simple belief. If we make models bigger, then smarter behavior will eventually emerge, essentially like scaling, like just full on scaling laws, right? But this belief powered the era of scaling laws, larger models, larger data sets, larger compute budgets, and then for a while it worked spectacularly well. But underneath the surface, something quieter and far more interesting has been happening. In this article, I'll show you experimental evidence that intelligence does not scale the way that we think it does. More specifically, the space of correct solutions is small. Increasing the size of the search space does not increase intelligence. It only increases redundancy. And this isn't just philosophy. I'm not making a philosophical claim. This is a measurable claim that I can make out that's borne out through this research paper. I can give you experiments on it, and that we're going to talk about all throughout this video, right? And then so the missing concept of this is the solution space itself. And then so most people are familiar with the parameter space being the weights, the latent space I talk about a lot being the embeddings, or the search space, which is like the space that like Google operates in, right? Which is like all possible outputs that a model can produce. But very few people think about the solution space. And the solution space is not all possible answers. It's not all possible thoughts, and it's not all possible generations. It's the set of internal states that reliably lead to correct decisions. In other words, where inside the model does knowing the answer actually live? The question turns out to matter for more than how many parameters that the model has. And then to me, this question overall is the most significant question when it comes to AI, period, right? And this concept is a hard concept for people to understand and to grasp within this. So when you think of and you learn of a model and that it operates off of weights, et cetera, the first concept is that like the model would store this information directly in the weights, right? That like, so let's say I take a string of weights and those string of weights would be representative directly of a concept, but that's not how it works whatsoever or at all. Like the model does not store any information directly in the weights. So then where does it store this information, right? And then so that's where the geometric latent space and all of that is where I get into and I've talked a lot about within and on this channel in that, like, so that's where the models store these answers and where that solution exists, right? But then so the important concept to understand within this is that there's a difference, a 100% difference and a provable difference between that space of where that solution actually exists, where it lives, and then where the model needs to search for the solution, right? Like the model needs to search for the solution within a huge area, but then the solution exists only in a flat surface of the area. Like think of it like a mountain, right? And then the very first time, Mount Everest, like the very first time that I want to, if Mount Everest is unexplored, I'm the very first person to do it. I have to explore the whole entire solution space, right? My, like, the whole entire mountain is my solution space because it's 100% unexplored. Like, there's no path, right? Sherpas and they create a path, and then that if I'm going after the Sherpas, then there's a path that exists within the solution space, right? And then so my solution space is no longer Mount Everest. My solution space is just flat out the path that the Sherpas carved out. And I know, like, I don't know like what where that path goes, but I know that the Sherpas carved it out, right? So then if I just follow that path, then I'm good. And then that's the same exact concept that we're dealing with here with regards towards knowledge construction inside of these models, essentially. And then so a thought experiment within that. Imagine a massive library with billions of books. If the answer that you need exists in one specific paragraph, does adding more books actually help? It only helps if you find that it only helps you to find that paragraph. But once you know where it is, the rest of the library becomes completely irrelevant. All that matters is in terms of research and knowledge is where is that paragraph? Where is that path? And then that paragraph, that path is the solution space. And then so the hypothesis is that the core hypothesis we tested was simple. Large models contain many solution spaces, but each solution space is small. If this is true, then something radical should be possible. We should be able to distill a model's intelligence by extracting only its solution space and not the entire model. Not teacher-student distillation, not logits, not imitation, just the solution geometry itself. This is a super important hypothesis to talk about and to dive into within this. So my hypothesis within this is not 100% generalized to human intelligence because no one has ever framed human intelligence in these terms before, right? It's always the exact opposite. And then so I don't want to make the leap to that specifically just because of that, but there's nothing else inherent within this that prevents me from making that specific leap. And I want to make that very apparent within this. Human intelligence is very much built off of it, like a specialization model, right? And then and we think of humans as a general intelligence, as generalizable. And then this is saying the opposite, that humans are just like very good, like we have enough solution space to like stack multiple individual solutions, and then those multiple individual solutions at a certain point then become and look like generalization, but it's generalization doesn't actually exist at least in the models. And then so that's what we're talking about within this, and that's the hypothesis within that. And then so the experiment is taking a teacher-student model, right? But starting with the teacher, a large language model trained to perform well on world geography multiple choice questions. And then within that, I'm taking a 3 billion parameter model, and I'm training it on like a high school geography data set. Then I'm taking a student model, which is a much smaller decoder-only model trained from scratch, which is like a 200 million parameter model trained from complete scratch, and that's the student model. And then the task is world geography multiple choice questions. So there's four options per choice. And then the key question is can we transfer only the solution space from teacher to student? And does it work better than standard methods, which would be like knowledge distillation? And then so extracting just the solution space. So instead of copying outputs or probabilities, we did something different. For each question, we asked the teacher to internally represent each answer option. We measured how these representations differed relative to each other. Then we removed irrelevant variants. And then we applied sceptic calculus to find the minimal basis that explains the teacher's decision geometry. And then what emerged from that was pretty striking. The solution space is tiny, very tiny, exactly as this research paper states overall. When we probe the teacher, 8 dimensions already captured most of its decision behavior, and then 16 to 20 dimensions captured like 99.98999% of it. And then so adding more dimensions did nothing. Even though the teacher has billions of parameters, its correct decisions live in about a 16-dimensional subspace. Distilling the solution space. We trained the student in 4 ways. We started off with just our baseline, so normal training on correct answers, and then we had our correct answer baseline plus KL knowledge distillation, so like traditional knowledge distillation, and then we had our solution space matching, so a traditional answer plus solution space matching, and then like geometry matching basically, and then all three as the combined method, and then throughout that, what we can see is that the geometry method very specifically and very clearly was the winner, secondarily by the combined, and then the very worst performing method overall was your standard knowledge distillation. And then so solution space distillation beat every other student method. Traditional distillation actually hurt performance. And then scaling the solution space, the critical test. So we swept solution dimensions and a solution loss weight, and the result was unambiguous. Our performance peaked at about 16 to 20 dimensions, and then larger dimensions than that provided no benefit, and then overweighting the solution loss actually degraded performance. So this is the most important result of our entire project. The scaling law that failed. The implicit assumption behind scaling laws is that a bigger search space will translate into a higher chance of finding the solution. But what we observed instead was that the search space is huge, but the solution space is small. Performance depends on finding the solution space and not enlarging the search space. Once the solution space is captured, scaling stops helping. The best analogy and the best overall way that I can express this and stress this is chess-based algorithms, right? So when you build a chess-based algorithm, the best approach isn't to just increase the search space for the this is already known within all of this, right? You don't increase the search space for the chess algorithm inherently, because that just increases like the number of like wrong or like bad moves that it could make, right? You only care about making sure that the model focuses on the right move rather than increasing the number of moves of possible moves that it could possibly make. And then so algorithms got very good at being able to figure that out, right? And we've overcome those things within this. It just hasn't been framed in that same context before with regards towards overall intelligence and problem solving. And why not? Because it's not a logical leap, but once you put all the pieces together, there it is, right? And so why this matters overall, this reframes intelligence itself. Large models are not intelligent because they're large. They're intelligent because they contain many compact solution manifolds. So it's throughout that constant training, it's training like individual solution spaces that get stacked onto each other. And then once you have like 100 or 1,000 or a million of those solution spaces, you're like, oh, this is general intelligence, right? And then that's how it breaks down. But it's just individual solution spaces, and it always will be. So scaling increases the number of solution spaces, improves access to them, but does not increase their dimensionality. Solution space will always be small and not curved. And then, so why traditional distillation fails? Traditional distillation copies decision surfaces and not decision structure. It teaches what the model chose and not why the choice was stable. Geometry-based transfers geometry, relative option structure, invariances, and robustness. If it transfers how the solution is represented and not just the result, which creates essentially a new mental model. Think of a large model as a library of solution manifolds. Distillation shouldn't copy the entire library. It should extract the few pages that matter. And then the broader claim is that intelligence does not scale with search space. It scales with the discovery and reuse of small solution spaces. Scaling helped us find these spaces, but once found, they're compact, reusable, and transferable. And then so this means, and this shows that, like, and what we're seeing across the board is that in these limited domains, that these smaller models are going to 100% absolutely outperform a larger model in a narrow domain because of the fact that it has less resources overall to compete with, to add noise to it overall, basically, right? So we're seeing the opposite of scaling, of these scaling laws come to fruition. Like, it's essentially the opposite bet, right? And then so where this leads, this suggests essentially like new directions: manifold level distillation, modular intelligence, task-specific solution extraction, and then smaller, faster, more controllable models. And it challenges the idea that the future of intelligence is simply more parameters, which isn't true. And then so as a final thought, we didn't shrink the model, we shrank intelligence itself, and it still worked. And then that should change how we think about AI overall. And essentially, to me, the era of open AI, of scaling laws, of everything that open AI was built off of is dead. is what all of this frames out to and boils down to. I 100% do think that in 2026, we're going to see a correction within AI and around AI, just like we did within the internet, right? And the internet age. And then so during the internet age, I'm old, right? I'm a dinosaur. And then so there was there were two companies, I'll bring them up, that were huge in the early days of the internet, Earthlink and Netscape, right? And then so if I mentioned those two names, and if I had mentioned those two names to you in the 1990s, especially in the mid-90s, it would be impossible for you to imagine a world that exists where neither of those companies exist, right? But if I mention Earthlink and Netscape to my kids, they're not going to know what either one of those companies are. Those companies don't even exist anymore and haven't existed for a couple of decades now, right? At least in terms of possibly. But I don't know when their actual end date is. But within that, it just shows and showcases to you that being head and first within this and that pole position early on isn't going to matter post the reckoning, right? Earthlink and Netscape are open AI to me. Where I'll leave it at that. And so overall, I'll leave it at that. And if you like this type of content, please like and subscribe. Thank you very much.